Penguin Random House Audio presents The Curse of the Marquis de Sade, a notorious scoundrel, a mythical manuscript, and the biggest scandal in literary history, by Joel Warner. Read for you by Stephen Mendel. For Emily, Gabriel, and Charlotte, who enjoy a good story as much as they love a grand adventure. In the end, Sade taunts his executioners. He has passed beyond the waves of the Black Sea. But in spite of you, O infernal pedants, despite your cries, his honest works will go without you to the Temple of Memories. He's done enough to earn glory, and far too much to earn his rest. The Marquis de Sade, my epitaph. Friend reader, as they said in the prefaces of old, if you know how to appreciate good old books and amusing characters, do me the favor to accompany me. Alfred Bonaldo, The Mirror of the Parisian Bibliophile, A Satirical Tale. Prologue. The Prisoner in the Tower. October 22, 1785. As the setting sun slipped below the tiled roofs of late 18th century Paris, a solitary convict leaned over his desk in the Liberty Tower of the Bastille and began to write. The extensive wars that Louis XIV had to wage throughout the course of his reign, while exhausting the state's finances and the people's resources, nevertheless uncovered the secret to enriching an enormous number of those leeches, always lying in wait for the public calamities they provoke, rather than quell in order to profit from them all the more. It was towards the end of this reign that four among them conceived the unique feat of debauchery we are about to describe. The man's fine-tipped quill moved quickly across the narrow sheet of paper, filling the page with delicate, almost microscopically small letters, the lines of brown ink crammed so close together to save space that the descenders of his J's, P's, and Y's stabbed like lancets into the line below. As he wrote, the light from his shaded candles flickered about the whitewashed stone walls of his cramped octagonal cell. The air rank from the waste that poured from the sewer pipe under his window into the moat below. Past his cell door, the prison echoed with the creaks of doors, clattering keys, and bolts slamming into place, the only signs that he wasn't completely alone. In the cold evening, shadows played across the trappings allowed to a prisoner of his aristocratic stature, shelves sagging with 600 books, with titles by Homer, Newton, and Shakespeare, as well as works on the existence of God, the motion of fluids, and the history of vampires. Expensive bottles of eau de cologne, fine linen towels, velvet cushions, and colorful tapestries stretched across the walls, and a prized collection of dildos, fashioned from rosewood and ebony, crafted to exacting specifications by a prominent Parisian cabinet maker. The cell's occupant was one of the most notorious criminals in 18th century France. He had spent the bulk of his 45 years reveling in depravity, engaging in blasphemous acts with a prostitute, torturing a beggar, poisoning whores, hiding in Italy in the romantic company of his sister-in-law, locking away girls and boys in his chateau for his own sexual designs, and narrowly surviving a bullet fired at his chest. For years, he had evaded the law, breaking out of an Alpine prison, dodging a military raid on his home, absconding from the clutches of a police squadron, and eluding his own public execution. His name was Donatien Alphonse François de Sade, but most people knew him as the Marquis de Sade. Sade's exploits had come to an end with his capture in 1778. He had first been assigned to the Chateau de Vincennes, a royal residence turned prison in a hunting preserve outside Paris, where he had briefly been interned as a much younger man. For 6 years, he had lived in a damp and rodent-infested cell whose narrow windows provided only the faintest hint of daylight. Then, in 1784, authorities had shut down Vincennes and transferred him to an even more dismal facility, the Bastille. Located near the heart of Paris, the Bastille was one of the most notorious prisons in all of Europe. With his arrest warrant signed by the king, Sade had been locked away with no charges, no trial, no possibility of appeal. For all he knew, he might never be released. The time behind bars had taken its toll on Sade's once fine figure. Inactivity and a penchant for delicacies sent to him by his wife, eel pâté, chocolate cakes, bacon-wrapped thrush, had left him obese. He was plagued by migraines, gout, nosebleeds, breathing problems, dizzy spells, and hemorrhoids so painful he needed a special leather cushion to sit at his desk. With his eyesight nearly ruined, he'd taken to wearing strange mask-like leather goggles. In his mounting delusion, he'd come to perceive a secret code of numerical signals concealed within his monotonous existence. The number of days he'd been imprisoned, the number of letters and packages he received, the amount of times he'd stimulated himself sexually in his cell. He believed that these ciphers, once cracked, would reveal the date of his release. At other times, he concluded that he was going mad. Sade had developed one obsession that eclipsed all others, a need to put quill to paper. "It is impossible for me to turn my back on my muse," he wrote in a letter. "It sweeps me along, forces me to write despite myself, and, no matter what people may do to try to stop me, there is no way they will ever succeed." He composed endless letters, essays, plays, and novellas, launching a literary career whose reputation would linger long after he was gone, resulting in a body of work so violent and obscene that its author would be variously described as the freest spirit who ever lived, an apostle of assassins, and a professor emeritus of crime. Thanks to his writing, Sade would be so deeply associated with cruelty and perversion that his name would become synonymous the world over with deriving pleasure from pain. But nothing would match the vulgarity of the effort he began this October evening. Experts would come to call the results one of the most important novels ever written and the Gospel of Evil. The work was titled 120 Days of Sodom, or The School of Libertinage. The novel tells the story of four wealthy degenerates, a duke, bishop, judge, and financier, who engage in a four-month orgy for which they gather 32 subordinates, their four young wives, eight virile men, four elderly female prostitutes, and, as the prime targets of their crimes, 16 boys and girls ages 12 to 15. Selected from a group of several hundred children kidnapped from their homes. In the telling, the four nobles and their retinue retreat to a mountaintop chateau in the depths of Central Europe, a heavily fortified citadel called Silling Castle. Thanks to walled-up exit gates, impassable chasms, and impenetrable snowdrifts, there is no hope of escape. As the Duke, the most domineering of the four, tells several of the prisoners, "You are already dead to the world, and it is only for our pleasures that you are breathing now." In Silling Castle, amid sumptuously furnished apartments, soundproof compartments, and torture chambers buried deep in the earth, the four noblemen subject their young victims to 120 days of escalating depravity. The first day involves one of the old prostitutes recounting a story, tying together priests, pedophilia, and body fluids. It is the tamest episode in the novel. Day after day, as the perversions escalate, the descriptions become ever starker, with all semblance of narrative falling away. Eventually, all that remains is a blunt list of horrors: incest, bestiality, coprophilia, necrophilia, starvation, disemboweling, amputation, castration, cannibalism, and infanticide. By the end of the novel, the chateau is awash in blood and body parts. The very act of reading the story from end to end seems to exact a physical toll.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.